Order the planning commission meeting for today, Wednesday, August 12th at 7:30 PM. Can we get a roll call, please?
Commissioners Austin?
Present.
Brooke?
Present.
McClellan's excused. Rose?
Present.
Scheffler?
Here.
Chief?
Here.
And Chair Carter Bowen?
Here. Okay. So now we're going to move down to the, are there any corrections or approval for the minutes? Or motion for approval for the minutes?
Move to approve minutes from, and adopt the minutes from June 17th, 2020.
I'll second that.
Okay, now we'll have a public comment at this time.
Actually, Chair, if we could do a roll call on the minutes?
Okay, my apologies. And can we have a roll call for the minutes, please?
Oh, sure. Commissioners Austin?
Yes.
Brooke?
Yes.
Rose?
Yes.
Scheffler?
Yes.
Chief?
Yes.
And Chair Carter Bowen?
Yes. All right, so now we'll move down to public comment at this time. Staff, did we receive any public input?
There's been no public input received. Thank you.
Okay. This closes the public input section, and now we will move to the public hearing. We have public hearing number one, CUP 2020-0002. May I have the staff report, please?
Sure. Thank you, Honorable Chair and members of the Planning Commission. Good evening. I'm just going to share my screen here. Okay, can you all see that okay? Is that accessible?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, this is a request by Lawrence Chow, the project architect, for a conditional use permit to build two new two-story single-family homes on a residential lot at 1701 Las Alamitas. This property is generally located on the southwest end of town, just south of the I-210 freeway. It's in the planned development area, PD-11 zone, as shown in purple on the map. The general plan's vision for this area is the feel of a single family neighborhood, but still allows multiple units on larger lots. And there are plenty of larger lots in this area that are in the 15 to 20,000 square foot range. And this one fits in with that, that category. This property is located on the west side of Alamitas, where it intersects with Fano Street, just north of West Duarte. The neighborhood is mostly lower density. It has some multifamily and some newer single family homes. There's a planned unit development just north of this property with newer two-story single family homes. This particular lot is almost, it's 19,462 square feet, almost a half acre. And it's currently developed with a one-story single-family home. And just to give you some context, these next couple of slides will show you what the neighborhood looks like at this time. The picture on the left is the subject site. You can see the existing single-story, single-family home with that planned unit development of newer single-family homes just beyond it in the background. These were built in the early 2000s, and they have a craftsman-style design. I want to point out that the design features of these homes are what we call they're modulated. You know, some of their wall planes project out and recess in so that they don't have a very bulky or massive appearance. Another notable development, another notable feature of this development is that they all have a unifying craftsman theme, where you have gabled roof lines and overhanging eaves that are very characteristic of the craftsman style. Here are some more images of the west side of Alamitas, which is the same side as the subject site. The blue house with the white trim on the left was built in the late 1980s, and I would say that this is characteristic of what the general plan envisions is the feel of a single-family home, but with multi-family units. This house, this blue house with the white trim, looks like a single-family house in the front. It has a main front door and a porch, but actually there are five units in that structure, and so that's the kind of characteristic of this PD11 that we're looking for, looking like a single-family neighborhood, but having multiple family units on the lots. The other two pictures to the right are also on Alamitas. They're one story, but they're multi-family developments. Across the street from Alamitas, there are more single-story structures. There's a two-story apartment complex, not really exhibiting that single-family look, but it is pretty much the only building like that on Alamitas, and that's closer to South Duarte. Back to the project site, we have a one-story, almost 2,000 square foot house that was originally built in 1953. It would be completely demolished for this project. The house was altered and rebuilt in 2014 with the appropriate city approvals and permits. Since the home's reconstruction occurred after the adoption of our demolition review ordinance, it's not considered potentially historic and doesn't require any evaluation for historic significance before it's demolished. Here's an aerial view of the site as it exists today. The remainder of this half-acre property is largely undeveloped. It's not vegetated. There are two mature trees in the back that will remain. We're not sure what the species of those trees are, but they're not protected trees, and they will remain as part of the development. There's also a vast amount of hardscape that you can see very visible there, a circular driveway and a new driveway that seems to go nowhere on the south end of the property. So the applicant is proposing to build two single-family homes on the lot. The front house is identified as Unit A here. It's 3,378 square feet in area with four bedrooms and a three-car garage. The back unit is Unit B and measures 2,989 square feet. Also has four bedrooms, but only a two-car garage. Here are some color elevations of the two homes. The front unit is on the left, as it would appear facing Alamitas. The front side of the rear unit is shown to the right. The development has one comprehensive design theme with the Spanish-style elements, including the hip roof lines, asymmetrical facades. Each has a squared entrance tower, large focal window. Notice the massing or bulk is broken up with the slight projection and recession of the front wall planes. Unit A's street-facing facade has wooden corbels under the roof eaves, a wood-planked door, decorative iron railing around that Juliet-style balcony in the front, and a parabolic-shaped focal window in the front with distinctive wing walls there and that little one-story projecting element there. Unit B would have a tiered cornice under the roof eaves, modest arched entry with angled wing walls, and a focal window with wooden shutters. So all these elements contribute to a comprehensive Spanish style theme. For vehicular access, the circular driveway provides access to Unit A's street-facing garage doors, and the front yard setback here is 45 feet. The zoning code does require a deeper front yard setback when you have a circular driveway. And then a second driveway along the north side of the lot leads to the rear house, Unit B, where there's a two-car garage and a guest space right next door to it. And then here's the open space plan for the two units. The backyard of Unit A provides 2,100 square feet of recreation space, and the rear yard behind Unit B is about 4,200 square feet. The architect has also given us a conceptual landscape plan. The space within the bend of the horseshoe there in the front would feature some turf and shrubs and a water fountain in the center. And the driveways would be paved with a stamped concrete. The side yards would remain landscaped with turf and palm trees as they are today, but additional shrubs and trees will be added to the side yard and in the back along the rear property line. Along the rear property line, the architect's proposing Australian willows. These are evergreen trees that grow to about 30, 35 feet tall and 20 feet wide, so they would act as screening trees. And then along the side yards, he's proposing columnar junipers on the sides. They're these upright pillars of green foliage that grow to 15, 18 feet tall. But a final landscape plan will be required before building permits are issued, the final details. Each house would have hidden trash enclosures and air conditioning units within the side yards, but they're beyond the setback lines, which is indicated in that solid red line within the property lines there. This project provides very generous setbacks. There's only a few portions of the building where they actually come right up to the setback line. The homes are also 55 feet apart in between. Here are some side elevations of the home as they would appear from the north along the driveway. The buildings would reach the maximum height limit of 27 feet. The exterior walls are primarily stucco with a sand coat finish. Here's a rear view showing the backsides of each unit. In addition to the stucco, the architect is including a combination of wood and iron details all around the house, like the wood cornice trim under the roof eaves and wood corbels under the roof eaves of the front house. And the balconies have the iron railings. Here's another side view of the homes as they would appear to the neighbor to the south. Both homes have a very similar floor plan configuration. The front unit, Unit A, is a little bit larger. The first floor of each house has the kitchen, dining room, great room, and 1.5 baths. The only difference is really the front house has all four bedrooms on the second floor, and the back house is a little bit smaller, where they would have one bedroom on the first floor and three on the second floor. So all of the city's development standards for multifamily development are listed on the left on the table here. Even though it's a PD-11 planned development area, we use the zoning development standards of the medium density development standards for the design parameters of the project. The middle column shows us the requirement of each standard followed by the project's compliance with it. The project does comply with all of them, and I just wanted to note that homes over 2,000 square feet do require an extra parking space. There's a three-car garage in the front, and you could provide an open space if you have only a two-car garage, so that's the case in the back. So compliance with the zoning standards are important in this case because this project is subject to the state's Housing Accountability Act. The city cannot deny housing development when a proposed housing development meets all of the applicable objective general plan and zoning standards and criteria. This project was reviewed by the Development Review Committee, actually via the Community Development Director during the pandemic. The director did recommend approval of the project. We did receive one email about this project indicating that the person was not in favor of development on this site, And staff did try to follow up with that person to see if there was anything, any specific concerns they had, but we had not heard back from that person since then. So the project is subject to a series of conditions of approval with Soren data sheets 1 and 2, primarily addressing performance standards for the homes, including lighting and noise and construction impacts, things like that. Staff has also included the findings for approval of this project and is recommending approval. Both myself and the applicant are on the line in case there are any questions. We'd be happy to answer those at this time.
Okay, commissioners, do any of you have any questions regarding the staff report?
I don't have any questions. I'd just like to really say this is a nice project and it fits this community really nice. I've made 2 different trips down here to look at this, look at the surrounding communities, and it really fits really well. And I think it's a really nice project.
Madam Chair, I do have a question. Excuse me. It'll be directed towards staff or John. Regarding the window placements on the second story, was that thoroughly vetted in the planning process that they don't impede on the surrounding neighborhoods?
Yes. We feel that the placement of the windows are adequate. I do have a few extra slides showing that there's a lot of open space around this property. And if you look at the to the north, we have pretty much a private drive going to that planned development. There's basically backyard area all around there, so privacy doesn't seem to be very much of a concern here. It's also a fairly wide lot. This is about 78 feet wide, and the setback on each side is 8 feet, which we feel is a pretty good amount. Like I said, the architect's been pretty generous with the setback requirements, and is also planting a lot of vegetation on the side yards as well.
My other question is just a general information question. Are these planning, is the developer planning to rent these, or are these going to be owner occupied?
That's a good question for the applicant. These could not be sold individually. This is just
because they're not asking for a
subdivision,
a tract map change.
That's correct.
Okay, kind of answered my own question. That they are. Just as a general comment, I like the architecture. They do have some commonality to them, but yet they're different. So that's a good thing. And to staff, presentations are really good in this environment where we're meeting remote. I appreciate the graphics.
Madam Chair, I have a question. Is there an existing wall around that property? And if so, what type of wall is it and will it remain?
Yes, there is an existing wall that will remain. It's a concrete masonry unit type of wall.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions from the commissioners? Okay, so at this time, we're going to open the public testimony portion of the hearing. This is the time and place for public input. And first, we would like to hear from the applicant. We'd ask that each person state their name and address for the record, please. Is the applicant available?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. My name is Lawrence Chow. I'm the architect of the project. I live in 2144 Oakdale Avenue in Roland Heights. And as we state in the development statement, the owner bought these properties about 3 years ago, and he liked to have the family members live close to each other. So he decided to put the 2 new houses. And in the past few months, I worked with John closely, and in terms of all the requirements, setbacks, driveway and building features. So we came up with this solution, and owner liked that very much. And I hope the city will also like this project. So I support this project wholeheartedly.
Okay. Are there any persons in favor? Are we supposed to take information from any persons in favor?
Did we get any other comment?
We received no comments on this.
No comments?
So we have no further comments.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So unless the commission has any other comment or questions for the applicant, it would be appropriate to close the public testimony.
Okay. So at this time, we will close the public hearing. Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, this is Daryl Brook. I move to have conditional use permit 2020-0002 approved.
Okay.
This is Bill Schief. I'll second that motion.
Okay. So I think now is staff, may we have a roll call?
Mm-hmm. Commissioners Austin?
Yes.
Brooke?
Yes.
Rose?
Yes.
Scheffler?
Yes.
Schief?
Yes.
And Chair Carter Bowen?
Yes.
I'll just read for the record that the decisions of the Planning Commission may be appealed if filed in writing within 10 days, and note that there is a appeal fee required.
Okay. Thank you, Craig. So now we'll move on to public hearing number 2, CUP 2013-02, amendment, and CUP 2020-006. I think we're gonna ask for a roll call at this time.
Well, give you the staff report. So Austin will be giving you that staff report. But before we go into that, I just wanna, this is a kind of a exciting project for me personally, because we worked with the applicant. This is our first microbrewery that came into town. And when they came into the counter and they said they wanted to do a microbrewery, we looked at each other like, what are we supposed to do with that? Because we didn't have any regulations. So they were terrific to work with. We figured this out together between staff and the applicant and the commission to come up with some good guidelines. So we're very excited that they're coming forward tonight for an expansion. So that I will go ahead and turn it over to Austin to give you the staff report.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Craig, for the wonderful introduction. Let me just share my screen real quick. All right, can everybody see that okay?
Yes.
Well, thank you again, Chair and Commissioners. Tonight before you, we have CUP, an amendment to CUP 2013-02, and a new CUP 2020-006 for the existing microbrewery for Pacific Plate Brewing Company. And they're requesting to expand from their existing location at 1999 South Myrtle Avenue into a new location at 2015 South Myrtle Avenue, as well as modifying those hours of condition. I'm sorry, they're moderating their hours of operation. And then the new CUP is for providing live entertainment, of which they do not have currently, similar to other businesses within the city. And the applicant's name is Mr. Stephen Cardenas. So as stated, the proposed locations is 1999 and 2015 South Myrtle Avenue. This runs along South Myrtle Avenue, just south of Spanner Street. And the zone for this particular area is actually a planned development area 16 zone. And this is a very unique zone in that off of the east side off of South Myrtle Avenue, is industrial and with some commercial space. And off of the west side, which you, it's a little cut off, but is Peck Road. And everything along Peck Road is actually residential. So it's kind of a split between commercial, I'm sorry, industrial, commercial, and residential. And that's indicated by that orange dividing line. It's maybe a little hard to see. As I stated, the existing microbrewery is about 1,650 square feet at the existing 1999 South Myrtle Avenue location highlighted in orange. And they're proposing to expand into an additional unit directly catty-corner at 2015 South Myrtle Avenue, which is around 2,075 square feet. So that puts them at a total of their for business for about 3,725 square feet. And this is actually beneficial in a few multiple ways. One is that with the combined space, they'll get a slightly larger tasting room, which they want to use for their expansion. In addition to that, it's actually pushing the tasting room. It's moving it from the 1999 location to the new 2015 location. And that will provide a 100-foot buffer between the live entertainment use and the residential that's next door to the west. When you break down the math for the required parking, it requires 10 spaces in total for the entire business, and that's between both the industrial use and the tasting room for retail. The applicant is providing 12 parking spaces. If you were divided up, he has basically four dedicated to the 1999 and eight for the 2015. But in total, he's providing 12 spaces. However, the entire lot is actually split between three different parcels. So it's a shared parking of a total of 35 spaces that's available on site. So the existing location as it is today is 1999 South Myrtle Avenue, and this is split between its current manufacturing use and their current tasting room, of which they do not have any current live entertainment. So this is how it is as it is today. Unfortunately, with the pandemic, they're not currently open and hoping to open very soon. However, with the new proposed use, they're actually proposing to convert this entire space into strictly manufacturing use. And this is the location that's closest to the residential. The new 2015 location is going to be split between both manufacturing and a larger tasting room at about 750 square feet. And then as indicated in red, that will be their live entertainment area for their live entertainment, and that's at 35 square feet in total. So the existing hours of operation, they would wish to amend their existing CUP. It currently goes from 4 to 10 between Wednesday and Friday, 12 noon to 10 on Saturday, and 12 noon to 6 p.m. on Sunday. So they're proposing actually just to go Monday through Friday between 4 and 11, so an additional hour, and then on Sunday from 12 noon to 11 p.m. on Saturdays and Sundays, also just that additional hour for their main operations. As for the live entertainment, it'll still remain incidental to the microbrewery operation, similar to other microbreweries within the city. The live entertainment in the tasting room is going to have both amplified and non-amplified performances, and this can attribute to some acoustic nights, trivia nights, paint game nights, poetry readings, and some educational talks, which has come up before the commission before, again, in other microbreweries. And they're proposing it between one and three times per week maximum for a maximum of five performers at any given time. With regards to the hours of operation, strictly speaking about live entertainment, they're proposing only to have that live entertainment between 5 and 8 p.m. Monday through Friday, and then 12 noon to 8 p.m. Saturdays and Sundays. And those live band performances, the ones that are actually live and amplified versus non-amplified, they want it to occur strictly on Fridays and Saturdays only between 6 and 8 p.m. And those live entertainment in terms of amplified music, they're only proposing that to be about 3 to 5 times per year. With that, they want to, with their modified hours of operation for their tasting room conditions, that we are upgrading them to more conditions that are more current with other microbreweries that have come throughout the city over time. Again, this is the first microbrewery that's in town, so their conditions of approval are a little outdated in comparison to some of the others within the city. So they'll be given the same conditions of approval as those others, as indicated in the staff report, specifically for the live entertainment, that they ensure that the revised hours of operation of live entertainment is not going to impact the surrounding properties. The limitation on those hours will mitigate potential noise impacts to the adjacent residential units to the west. Obviously, it's going to be all limited to the inside the tap room or the tasting room specifically, as specified on the floor plan. And then all the exterior doors will remain closed at all times during live event hours. And staff is recommending and the DRC are recommending a 6-month review required for the live entertainment use to make sure that there isn't additional noise complaints and things like that. We did send out a notice of a 300-foot radius as well as the newspaper notice, and we did not receive any feedback from any of the surrounding residents. And with that, I am concluding my presentation, and staff is and the DRC are recommending an approval with conditions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for the report. Commissioners, are there any questions regarding the staff report?
I do, Madam Chair. You ready for me?
Yes.
All right, sorry about that. Good presentation, Austin. A couple questions on regarding on your last slide and the commencement of a 6-month review at the bottom there. But that, you know, don't know if these are operating now. I make the assumption under the COVID restrictions, they're probably not having people in their tasting room. Would that 6-month apply when they're, you know, ready to go and we're post this COVID and they're allowed to have occupants? Or is that 6 months when they're, you know, ready to go? Because it might not be a good measurement of the live entertainment, even though I don't think there'd be a problem.
Agreed. The 6 month is one we've applied to other microbreweries within the city, and it's usually started when they start the use. So they would have to still get building permits to do all the interior work. But once they commence that use in terms of the live entertainment and the expanded hours, then we require that 6 month review. So for the live entertainment only, then we would require it 6 months from when they can start live entertainment. And obviously, he doesn't know when he's going to open up yet with everything going on, but hopefully when that day comes soon, then that 6 months would start.
Okay. Bobby, follow up to that would be, under other breweries that have live entertainment, we had any feedback, positive or negative, on those?
Not currently yet. There's a few others, specifically Wingwalker Brewery is the last one that was approved. Their 6 month is coming up during the pandemic. They've also had to shut down. So once they reopen, that'll be coming before the DRC for their review. Nothing currently in terms of positive or negative either way yet.
One more question. It's regarding, it would be on data sheet number one, item number 59, the occupant load. And you had a real good slide up there with the number of seats. And I noticed that they didn't, I was curious, that was vetted through the fire department, the occupant load?
Correct.
They had no feedback.
You mean between the feedback from?
Just seemed like a little high for the size of the space. I was just making sure that was fully vetted. You know, that'd be great if they could fill the, you know, and have 50 occupants, but we want to make sure it's safe.
For the total area of the building, which is again 2,075 square feet, for the retail scenario, it should be a maximum of 49 persons. They're only providing within the mid-30s for their seats. But that was vetted through review when we send the plans to fire and building, as well as public works.
Great, thank you.
And just to clarify, that 49, that's a trigger number, that when you go over 49, it changes the occupancy, it changes the requirements for fire, it changes the requirements for building. So that's the reason that's in there.
Okay. Copy. I understand.
This is Bill Schieff. One quick question. Does it also change or trigger the number of parking spaces available?
It does not. So our parking requirement is based upon the use, and the use is broken down between 500 square feet for the manufacturing portion of the use And then the retail portion is done at around 200 to 250. So the live entertainment is again made to be incidental to the primary use, the primary use being the manufacturing of the beer specifically, rather than the entertainment use itself. So the live entertainment is actually doesn't increase the parking demand per the city code.
Thank you.
Austin?
Yes, sir.
Austin, if I'm understanding what you're saying, everything on the north side is going to be manufacturing. Everything that's going to be on the south, which would be the new building, that's going to be the wine tasting, or excuse me, the beer tasting and the live entertainment?
Partially. So the original location, which it is today, is the 1999 South Myrtle Avenue, and that will become 100% manufacturing use. The new location at 2015 will be a combination of both manufacturing and the tasting room, and that tasting room will hold the live entertainment.
Okay. Thank you.
Are there any further questions for staff? Okay. At this time, we're going to open the public testimony portion of the hearing. Is the applicant present, and would he or she like to speak? If so, please state your name for the record.
Hi, my name is Stephen Cardenas, and I'm the owner of Pacific Tide Brewing Company.
Hi there.
So I just want to say thank you guys for your consideration tonight. We're coming up on our 7-year anniversary here at Pacific Plate, and we're happy to be a part of the community here. And we strongly are for the approval of our new COP.
Does the commission have any questions for the applicant? Okay, no questions. Staff, do we have any public input? Anybody call in or email?
We did not.
Okay. So at this point, I think we close the public hearing.
Yes.
All right. And then commissioners, were there any other questions for the commissioner? I mean, for discussion, any other questions? If not, is there a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve the amended continuous use permit 2013-02 and the new continuous use permit 20-006.
I can second that since I was around on the original one.
Okay. So we have a first and second motion. Staff, may I have a roll call, please?
Mm-hmm. Commissioners Austin?
Yes.
Brooke?
Yes.
Rose?
Yes.
Scheffler?
Yes.
Chief?
Yes.
And Chair Carter Bowen?
Yes.
And Chair, if I can read the appeal language. The decisions of the Planning Commission may be appealed to the City Council if filed in writing within 10 days. Note, an appeal fee is required.
Okay, thank you. So now we will be moving on to public hearing item number 3, which is a city-initiated ordinance number 2020-10, Planning Commission resolution number 2020-0001. And may we have a report, please?
Yes, good evening, Chair and members of the Planning Commission. I have a presentation for you tonight regarding the proposed ordinance for accessory dwelling units and junior accessory dwelling units. My PowerPoint's being pulled up right now. But I can start by sharing that last year, as the Commission's aware, there were many housing bills that were passed. And there was a good number of those housing bills that actually focused on, actually focused and related to accessory dwelling units. law. And the purpose of these laws, were the intent is really to focus on housing production, stimulating housing production. And so those bills, which I have now shown on the screen, I hope you guys can all see it, collectively amended the state law with respect to ADUs. And those laws went into effect January 1st. And what that did was almost all of all the cities in California, their local jurisdictions, current ADU ordinances became null and void. So our city staff here has been actually reviewing and approving ADUs concurrent with and consistent with the state law. What we're proposing tonight is an ordinance that would bring the city standards into conformance with the new state law. So real briefly, what is an ADU? I'm sure you've heard this term on the street. An ADU is essentially is a smaller independent residential dwelling unit. It's located on the same lot as an existing housing unit. State law allows these to range in size from as small as 220 square feet up to 1,200 square feet. And they can be located through the conversion of an existing or proposed single-family dwelling. They could be created through the conversion of a detached accessory structure, including a garage. They can be created by new construction and just building one on your site, detached from the main dwelling unit, and then also doing an addition, making an attached ADU to the primary residence. So in addition to ADU, a JDU is a smaller type of living unit, and this differs from an accessory dwelling unit or ADU because JDUs are actually only allowed on single-family lots that are developed with single-family residences. They're much smaller. They range in size from 220 square feet up to 500 square feet, and they're contained entirely within an existing or proposed single-family dwelling. They must have an efficiency kitchen at minimum, but unlike ADUs, they are not required to have their own bathroom. They can actually share a bathroom with the main dwelling. And the pictures on the right side of the screen kind of give you an idea of how they're located. They can be created from a bedroom, but it's all interior space within a dwelling unit. So I'm going to be going over some of the key changes in state laws that are going to be incorporated into the City of Monrovia's ordinance. And what's important to know is that ADUs are known by many different names. In the 1990s, they were called second residential units or secondary residential units and granny flats. Some people called them mother-in-law units. And through the course of all these years, the state has constantly seen the need to produce these units because they're actually a form of affordable housing. They benefit many types of users, from adult children to seniors, or homeowners who just need to find some additional revenue to support their payments on a house, for example. And so because of this, these laws over the years have become more restrict to allow for their production, basically limiting the city's control. So some of the key changes is that these laws now require a streamlined ministerial approval process and an expanded land use potential for ADU and JDU development in the city. Our current 2017 ordinance that's actually null and void did have a ministerial process, but it allowed for departures from that process and certain types of ADUs to actually have to go through a discretionary review before the development review committee. New state law says that all accessory dwelling unit and JDU development has to be approved through administrative or ministerial process. Cities must also approve these applications within 60 days, and this is a shorter time frame. The previous time frame was 120. The city's 2017 ordinance allowed ADUs only on single-family lots that were developed with single-family residences. The new law says that everyone gets an ADU. All zoning districts allowing single-family or multifamily development where there's existing proposed development essentially is entitled to an ADU. And so what that does is our ordinance is now going to expand the capacity in which ADUs can be created in the city. It's going to expand to from our single-family, it's going to residential multifamily zones, any PD zone that allows residential development, including a commercial zone that allows residential development where there's an existing development, will be entitled to an ADU. The key changes in state law also put limited requirements on the types of covenants that the city can require for this type of housing. Prior ordinance had allowed the city to have an applicant record an owner occupancy covenant requiring the owner of an ADU to live in either the ADU or the main dwelling unit for all ADU developments. This can no longer be required. This owner occupancy provisions only now allowed in JDU developments, but the ordinance and state law still allows the city to prohibit the use of these units as short-term rentals. There's now more restrictive building setbacks. The city cannot require more than a 4-foot side and rear yard setback. Any type of ADU that's created through the conversion of existing space does not need to meet any setback. So you could have a structure that's set 2 feet from a property line. If it's a legal structure, it can be converted into an ADU. There is a new height limit. That maximum height limit is 16 feet. And the city of Monrovia staff is recommending to incorporate that height limit into the ordinance. The new standards allow for larger ADU sizes. As I mentioned, today the state law allows the range from 220 up to 1200, but it does allow the cities to put a cap no less than a minimum and for 2 bedrooms. And because of that, staff is incorporating and recommending that we set our maximum ADU limit size at 1000. The proposed ordinance is meeting the JDU size requirements of state law, which the maximum size of 500 square feet. And I think probably some of the most significant changes to ADU is the amount of parking that we can no longer require. So essentially, when an ADU is proposed, you could require 1 parking space for that ADU. But there's a lot of provisions that say, okay, if for example, you're demolishing a garage or converting a garage, you don't actually need to replace that parking that was the parking for the main dwelling unit on the site. You also do not need to provide parking if your ADU is created through the conversion of existing space located within a half mile walking distance of public transit, if it's located in a historic district, or in a district where permit parking is available but not available to an ADU occupant, or if it's located within 1 block of a car share program. Another notable change in ADU law is that there are certain types of ADUs that now have to be approved by right through a building permit only process. That means they can bypass planning division review. They're not subject to any specific local development standards. They can go right to building to obtain their permit. And because of this, we have created 2 avenues within the Monrovia ordinance. It allows the by right and identifies which types of ADUs are allowed by right with that permit, building permit process only. And then we also have a planning division review process where we were able to incorporate some local development standards for the purpose of protecting Monrovia neighborhoods and our historic resources. But what's important to note is any of these standards could not deny an eligible property for at least 1 ADU. And that's very key. In our former ordinance, if a site was maximized on floor area ratio or lot coverage, there was no room for an ADU. That's not the case anymore. Even if they've maximized it, everyone is entitled to at least 1 ADU structure of maximum 800 square feet. So what type of ADUs can you just walk into City Hall to get a building permit for? Well, an ADU that's created within a proposed single-family dwelling having a maximum size of 800 square feet, an ADU that's created within an existing single-family dwelling or an existing detached accessory structure, again with a maximum size of 800 square feet, An ADU, new detached structure, meeting that 800 square foot limit, maximum height of 16, side and rear yard setbacks at 4. And you can also build an ADU and a JADU if you're together, if your ADU is a maximum size of 800 square feet. So building permit only process related to multifamily developments. So this is new for Monrovia because our former standards did not allow ADU development on multifamily developed lots. The new standards do allow for ADUs to be created through the conversion of non-habitable space within a multifamily building. And those non-habitable spaces can be garages, closets, storage room. To the right, I have a picture of an apartment building and what may have been a garage, and you can see what one type of conversion may look like. The number of ADUs on multifamily zone properties that are developed with multifamily are allowed at least one, but up to 25% of the existing number of units in that building. And an additional one detached unit. So you can see that the number is increased in order to meet the housing production for the state. So now I'd like to just slide into talking about what types of development standards, in addition to the state standards, that we do have some local control on. And with respect to focusing preservation on our neighborhoods and historic resources, we are recommending provisions relating to designated landmarks and contributors in districts. So for these standards would be for any ADU that does not fall into the category of a by right approval through building permit issuance. In these cases, an ADU that change, if you're a designated landmark or you're a contributor, you would not be able to make any changes to the street facing facade. Any other changes to the exterior of the building on the sides or rear would need to match exactly in materials and colors and siding. And then if your property is landmarked and also has a Mills Act contract, you would still be subject to the approval of a certificate of appropriateness by the Historic Preservation Commission, because that is a term within the contract with the city. And additionally, there are some design standards, but these design standards are very objective. New construction must have the same architectural style, colors, and siding, and that's really to make sure the new construction would be compatible with the main dwelling unit on site. So as you can see, I've ran through a lot of this real quickly, but in a nutshell, there's a lot of new laws that were passed, and these laws, staff spent a great deal of time reviewing these laws with each other and with our city attorney. Some of the laws are kind of vague and gray, so we wanted to make sure that we were putting together an ordinance that was met the set state standard, but was also Monrovia-centric. Staff is recommending the approval of this ordinance. It's an identified priority task on the city's planning home program, which was put in place for the production of housing. It's also consistent with our housing goals, especially housing element goal number 2. So for this reason, we are recommending that the Planning Commission adopt Resolution 2020-001. This would be to recommend that the City Council approve the ordinance. And I am available to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Sherry, for the report. Do the my fellow commissioners, does anyone have any questions for Sherry regarding the report?
I have a couple questions. Sherry?
Yes.
How are you? Hey, I've got a couple questions. I did a research I'm not going to call it typical, but a basic in the city of Monrovia, 2-bedroom, 1-bath with a dining room. And basically it's 837 square feet. That's with an attached 2-car garage. That's not an uncommon house in this community. And my question is, I have a couple questions. Number one question is this: if you did an attached ADU to the back of the house, Okay, and I know there's setbacks already, you've already spoke about. So my question is this, the existing backyard, if you were to build an ADU to all code setbacks and everything has been approved, could the backyard, the existing backyard, does that backyard setback change that in the property that's next to the new ADU? In other words, if it's a 20-foot setback, 25-foot setback, would that backyard, rear yard setback, the part that's remaining that's not the ADU, would that be able to be cut in half, for example? Or is there a set, whatever it is, if it's 20 foot, 25 feet, would that have to remain at 25 feet?
Any type of new construction, the state says that the minimum setback requirements are 4 feet for side and rear.
Okay. I'm not being clear to you.
No, I think I understand your question. So if you have a home that's currently conforming with the rear yard setback,
and you built your
and they just meet that rear yard setback and they want to do an addition?
No. Oh. No. If you built it, say the house that I'm using for an example, has an attached 2-car garage. So if I did all everything as far as 4-foot setback, build an ADU directly behind, attached to the back of the garage, and it met all the required setbacks. If now you have a remainder of the backyard that's there untouched. My question is, in other words, if you had a 4-foot setback behind the new ADU, could you incorporate half of the existing backyard with that ADU? Not that you needed to, but it's just, would it be able to be adapted to it?
Yeah, if I am understanding correctly, I think you could.
Okay.
But what you couldn't do is you couldn't extend the main dwelling out to the same extent that you do with an ADU. And you
right.
couldn't.
No. All I would be saying is this, after the ADU is built, approved, and it's built, I would opt to say there's a remainder of, say, 50 feet by the depth of that back 20 feet. Could I incorporate half of that towards the ADU, even though the ADU meets its 4-foot setback? Does that make sense?
As long as it doesn't, the ADU can be as close as 4 feet.
Correct.
To either property line, regardless of whether it's attached or detached. There's no yard. We really can't apply yard requirements anymore. But it's only for the ADU square footage, not for the house.
Okay. I've got another question. In our packet, it says that if there's an existing house, you cannot build an ADU any larger than 50% of the original house. So the house that I'm using that I did research on is 837 square feet. That's the original house. So 50% would be 418 and a half feet, say 418 feet, okay? And my question is this, if you opted, 50% of the 837 is gonna be 418 feet. If I were to take a garage that was bigger than the 418, 20 by 21 garage is gonna exceed that 418 feet. Would I be able to still build that garage to an ADU? Does that make sense?
Yes. So basically, we've put standards into the regulations, including that 50% standard, which is based in state law. However, everybody gets an 800 square foot ADU that's 16 feet tall, regardless of any other provision. So we can't not prohibit anybody from doing 800 square foot ADU, even if it exceeds the 50%.
Okay, so with this 837 square foot house that I'm researching, if I wanted to go in there and build a 500 square foot ADU attached to the back of the existing garage, and all the rest of the setbacks comply with the new rulings, I'd be okay?
Yes.
Yeah. You could do up to 800 square foot ADU, even if the house is only 836 or 37 square feet, because we cannot prohibit that.
Okay, that's That's the questions I have for the ADU. I've got one question for a junior ADU.
Make it easy, Gary.
I'm just kidding.
It's very simple for me.
I'm just kidding.
No softballs, Gary.
Yeah.
No softballs.
Well, let me just say, these state laws are very difficult. Craig and I, we were pulling our hairs out trying to make... There's no silly question. So don't worry.
It's not a silly question. This is basically you've already covered the junior ADU.
Okay.
The junior ADU, I'm going to use this just a scenario. I'll simplify it. If you wanted to build an ADU, a junior ADU, and you have, this is going to confuse you guys. You got two bedrooms and a bathroom, and you have an existing 4050 window facing the backyard, could you actually, and it fits within the setback, could you actually do an external staircase and create a junior ADU? I mean, there's many properties in this town that have an external staircase, and they have a second story, which is not an ADU. There's a lower unit, upper unit. Could that feasibly in a single residential area, could that be acceptable as far as a junior ADU is concerned?
So you can convert any habitable space within a dwelling into an ADU. What's key is there's size limits, right? 220 is the smallest you can go, up to 500. It needs to have an efficiency kitchen, so a kitchenette, microwave, and then you don't need a bathroom in there. You could share a bathroom.
Okay, it
can have an exterior access. Is that what your question is?
That would satisfy the requirements for a junior ADU, and this would have its own bathroom.
Okay. Yes.
It'd have a little kitchenette. Would have its own bathroom. It'd basically be 368 square feet, if you will, but it would need the outside staircase. That's totally acceptable.
Sounds acceptable to me.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. That's it. Appreciate your time.
All right. You're welcome.
Thank you.
This is Bill Sheaf. I have a really silly question. assuming that an 800 square foot ADU cannot be prohibited, will ADUs be coming before the Planning Commission for approval?
No. So that's one key change in the state law, is that there's no type of public hearing review that's allowed. Everything has to be approved at a staff level, essentially, either through Planning Division and Building Permit process only.
All ADUs are ministerial decisions, so even minimal planning review for that. But so there is no, unless it's requesting a variance, then that would come before the Planning Commission. But that would be the only time.
Thank you.
Any other questions for staff? Okay, so is there public input on something like this? Sherry, Craig?
Yes, so thank you. The commission probably received a copy of a letter that staff received from Californians for Home Ownership. This was last year in November. They have been following several jurisdictions throughout California in their ADU ordinance development. Staff submitted a copy of the proposed ordinance to them, as well as the agenda, staff report, and we have not received any formal comments from them to date, or comments from any other person.
Okay. All right, thank you. So at this time, we'll close the public hearing. Any other further questions from the commissioners? Anything for discussion? If not, I'm going to ask for a motion, please.
I can move that we close the public hearing and adopt Planning Commission Resolution Number 2020-0001.
I'll second that.
Okay, thank you. Staff, may I have a roll call, please?
Commissioners Austin?
Yes.
Brooke?
Yes.
Rose?
Yes.
Scheffler?
Yes.
Chief?
Yes.
And Chair Carter Bowen?
Yes.
So this is scheduled to go before the City Council. We're looking at the 15th of September for their review. I also want a big shout out to our Assistant City Attorneys, Carol Lynch and Diana Verratt, who were extremely, extremely helpful in this. And like Sherry said, trying to read through the state law and make any sort of sense out of it was challenging. This was six different bills that didn't really talk to each other. So there is a lot of interpretation. We are required to send it up to HCD, the Department of Housing and Community Development, for their review. So they'll basically be approving it also in addition to the commission and the City Council. But this was definitely a team effort to get it to this point.
Okay, I think, am I correct? Now is the time for the Community Development Director report.
Yes, it is. We have a couple things for the commission. I'm going to turn it over to our Assistant City Attorney, Carol Lynch, to talk about some of the changes in the conflict of interest regulation. So with that, I'll go ahead and give it to Carol.
I better unmute, huh? thank you, Craig. As you all already know, planning commissioners cannot participate in any decision in which you have an economic interest. So if your business interests are affected, if you have real property interests that could be affected by a decision on another property, anything like that, you, as you know, are required to abstain from participating in the matter and recuse yourself. And you have to state with particularity why you're recusing yourself. So in other words, you have to say, I'm recusing myself because my property is within 500 feet of the property that's about to be developed. Now, they've changed the rules a bit because it used to be that if a commissioner didn't come to a meeting until after an item had been considered, they didn't really have to say anything about it because they weren't even in the room at the time when the item came up. The FPPC now has clarified that if you either come to a meeting after something's occurred or before, even if you leave long before this item is actually going to be considered, you have to make the same disclosure in the record before you leave the meeting, or in the other case, when you come to the meeting, even if it's after the item has been considered. So it's a kind of just a stylistic or procedural type of matter. But the point is, you can't just avoid the discussion or the disclosure simply because you happen to come into the meeting late. They don't really talk in this new rule about what happens if you don't come to the meeting at all. And so presumably that means that you don't have to make the disclosure. If you don't come to the meeting at all that entire evening, then that's the end of it. You shouldn't have to disclose unless they make another change to the rule, in which case I'll be giving you more news the next time around. But for now, that's what the rule is. Craig also suggested that because some commissioners have been on the commission for a while, it might be useful to talk about the fact that the rule has also changed about when you have to recuse yourself when you are within you own property that's within 500 feet or 1,000 feet of the property that's being developed. The rule used to be so nice and simple and clear. It was basically, if you're within 500 feet, you're presumed to have a conflict. If you're outside of 1,000 feet, you're presumed not to have a conflict. And if you were in the middle, they had, basically, they had certain tests that you wanted to go through, but it was pretty clear. Now, they've changed the rule to make it more onerous. So in other words, if you're within 500 feet, you're still presumed to have a conflict. You cannot participate unless, quote, there is clear and convincing evidence that the project will not have any, not one penny's worth of effect on the value of your property. That's a really tough standard. So the bottom line is, if you're within 500 feet, you still shouldn't participate, in my opinion. And I can't imagine how anybody could come up with evidence that was that clear and convincing that it wouldn't have a one penny effect on the value of your property. Likewise, you're still presumed not to have a conflict if you're beyond 1,000 feet, unless, again, there is clear and convincing evidence that shows that the development would have an effect on your property. So you're pretty safe if you're outside the 1,000 square feet. You shouldn't participate if you've got property within 500 feet, where they've kind of muddied the waters as they've come up with a whole list of criteria that you have to consider if you're within the 500 to 1,000 feet range. And basically, that you have to consider, will this proposed project affect the development potential, the income producing potential, the highest best use of my property, the character of my property? Will it change traffic patterns? Will it affect my view? Will it affect lights, the lighting, or cause potential noise? If anything like that would happen within this 500 to 1,000 foot range, then you still have to recuse yourself. So I just wanted to sort of go through those rules because, as with everything, it's becoming more complicated. I don't know if anybody has any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
I do, Carol. Thank you. One question would come back to Craig and staff. Sometime last year, you guys did a nice job and provided us with little maps. And I don't know if that was I think it was 500 feet.
Yes. But,
I guess we should probably get 1,000 foot or 750 feet radiuses and things like that, as straight as the bird flies. But could you give some examples, like when you're saying, you're at 750 feet and you're saying, well, if it changes the noise thing, and this might be a too hypothetical, some examples so we could kind of understand or play it in there. I can use an example. I'm outside the 500 foot range of the Aztec Hotel, but probably within the 750 foot range of it. How would that work for like myself?
Well, I would say that if you are within that range, if you think, for example, that you might hear noise from the Aztec Hotel, then you should recuse yourself or if there was light glare, if traffic patterns in the area might change, any of those things that might occur, you should recuse yourself from participating. You always want to err in favor of recusal because nobody can come out. It's a criminal violation. It's a misdemeanor if you make a mistake. So it's always better, when in doubt, sit it out, because nobody can ever come after you for making the decision to recuse yourself in a closed case.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions?
How would you do that in this case as we're speaking? If there were something came up, and I'll use myself for an example, you went away. There you go.
Oh, I'm here.
There you go. How would that take effect?
So if you thought that you had a conflict, first of all, please always bring it to our attention ahead of time, because especially the financial conflicts are like from a business and so forth are very tricky to work through. So if we know about this before the meeting, just back to the question too, even about the distance, if you're not sure, it's always good to have staff double check these things through their, you know, through GPS and other methods. But you would basically say, excuse me, Madam Chair, I cannot participate in the upcoming matter. I own property that's within 700 feet of the subject application, and I'm concerned that it could affect, there could be glare, there could be noise, and therefore I'm required by law to recuse myself. And then you'd get up from the dais, assuming we were ever back in a meeting again, but you get up from the, I guess we'd nuke you out from the screen, but you'd get up from the dais and you'd leave the room. There is just, I should point out one other thing is if your personal interests are actually affected, you can participate from the podium like any other member of the public. In other words, you're no longer a commissioner. You're not wearing that hat anymore. But you can say, because I do own property within this area, I support the application, I'm opposed to the application. You have that right when it's your own personal property interest. What you can't do is represent the interests of someone else in front of the commission when you have a conflict.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I just thought of a question for Carol. Like the action we just took tonight, could we not, does the law not say that we didn't increase everybody's values of their personal property or commercial property because we allow, you know, we're passing something on, or is that on the city council because they make the final, we're just passing it along because.
No, that's a very good question. There is a provision in the law called in the conflict law called the public generally exception. So that if a change that's being made, such as the ADU ordinance, is being made citywide and it affects a significant number of the entire population, because you as a commissioner are affected the same way as everybody else is, you can still participate. It's only if your interests are affected uniquely and differently from those of other Monrovia residents, then you'd have to still recuse yourself. But if you're, you know, you could perhaps build an ADU on your property, as can anybody else. And that would not be considered to be, you know, an interest that's distinguishable from anybody else's.
Carol, that's a great question. So right now, if I take a property that I own in the city of Monrovia, and you just said it, and I applied for an ADU permit, and I built an ADU, even though I voted on this, I'm part of it, it doesn't affect me. That's a great question.
That's correct. Because it affects you the same way as everybody else who owns property in the city of Monrovia. Now, if there was just a contrary type of position, if there was a zone change, for example, affecting only your immediate area of the city, and it wasn't affecting, quote, a significant number of Monrovians, then you would still have to recuse yourself. But here, this is a citywide ordinance that affects everybody who owns property in the city, basically, or at least residential property in the city.
Carol, what's considered significant?
There, it depends upon the population size, but basically, as I remember off the top of my head, I believe that if it affects over 25 or 30%, but I just have to double check the threshold. I want to make sure they haven't changed the rule on me and I haven't given you the wrong number, but it's a pretty large number.
Thousands of people.
Basically, yes, that's right.
Okay.
Anybody else? Thank you, Madam Chair.
And I have one more update, and I just want to make a comment to Commissioner Austin's point. We did provide the commission with a 500-foot radius. We're finalizing preparing the 1,000-foot radius, so we'll get that, be emailing those out to you in the next week or so. The other thing, I just wanted to give you a quick update. It was last week, it seems like ages ago, that we had the joint session with the city council to talk about some housing issues. Thank you I thought that was a, hopefully you got something out of it. There was a lot of information that staff presented, but I thought it was really important to start getting that conversation going. Housing is going to be a big discussion in the next year as we build the new housing element. We have released the request for proposals to hire a consultant. Those have to be in by September 1st, and then we anticipate taking a contract to the City Council for their consideration the first meeting in October. Once that contract's approved, we will hit the ground running, moving forward on the housing element. We have a year, but a year goes very quickly, and we want to certainly encourage as many people as possible to participate. So we will be having a lot of dialogue, and the Planning Commission is going to play a very important role in that process. So as things move along, we'll definitely be keeping you in the loop, and we'll be talking a lot about housing. The one other thing, you're going to get a presentation on this next month, but I just want to remind people that it's not too late to fill out your census. You have to go online and do it, or if you have the form, you can still mail it in. Monrovia is doing pretty good, but we have a few areas that are underrepresented in the count. The last I checked, I think we were just under 70% response rate, which is okay. We're slightly ahead of where we were last 10 years ago, but remind people it's really, really important to fill out your census. So, you know, if you tell five people and they tell five people and then we get the word out, and it'd be nice to get a much better representation. So our city clerk, Alice Atkins, will be giving you an update at your next meeting on this too. So, but I think it's never too much. We should never be talking about we can never talk too much about the census, is what I'm trying to say. So that concludes my updates, and I will turn it back over to the chair. Yes, Carol.
I just wanted to say I did double check in response to Commissioner Austin's question, and it is 25% is what qualifies for the public generally exception. So thank you.
Okay, thank you. Are there any additional items from the commissioners that need to be placed on future agendas or to be addressed by staff? Okay, so if there is nothing else, I do believe that this meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Sherry.
Thank you, Keisha.
Good job, Keisha. First go around. Good job.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thanks for your